Hello, Capital Church family. We are so glad that you are here today. It's the best day of the week, and I'm so excited for what God is going to do today. If this is your first time here, we are especially grateful that you are with us today. God is here, and I know that today's message is going to encourage you in your life in a whole new way. We would love to connect with you if this is your first time here. You can fill out a connection card by texting the word Capital Church to 94000. It'll only take a couple of seconds, so we can thank you so much for being a part of today's online church experience. Well, right now in this moment, let's open up our heart and engage in worship with Church of the Highlands.
Hey, what's up, everybody? We're so glad you're here to worship with us. Come on, let's sing together. You're the one I call. You are my foundation, a solid rock I will stand on. There's no need to fear, for the battle is won. The battle is won in you. My future is sure, for my God you are strong. My God you are breaking through. Death is defeated. I'll break through. in you. My future is sure, for my God, you are strong. My God, you are breaking through. There's no need to fear, for the battle is won. The battle is won in you. My future is sure, for my God, you are strong. My God, you are breaking through. Savior, we are alive for you.
wildest ocean. Oh, nothing else compares.
You're worthy, God. There's no other name but you, Jesus. It was my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name.
Well, good morning, Capital Church. We're so glad you joined us online this week. Listen, I want to remind you that in just a few weeks, we're going to be celebrating Easter right here at the Capital Church. And listen, if you joined us online last week or if you were here on campus, you would remember that I gave you a challenge, right? And that this challenge is to share your story, the story of what God is doing in your life with someone that God may be putting in your heart to share this with, and then to take it a step further and invite them to church and bring them to church with you on Easter Sunday. And so out of that, this Plus One campaign we launched last week came forth, and it's all about getting us ready and excited to bring people to Jesus, to bring people into celebrating the resurrection and the life of Jesus, and so that they too may find life in Him. Well, listen, we're gonna dive right in. I don't know about you, but I'm excited for church today. Truth is, I'm always excited about church, but I'm just grateful for the opportunity to come together and worship with you and share this word with you this morning. So we're gonna dive right in. So go ahead and turn on your Bibles, or if you're like me, pull out your actual Bible, something to write with, something to write on, and let's pray over this next part of our time together. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this time of worship. Thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the team that puts all this together, God. We just pray a blessing over this next part of our worship, God. May you open our minds and our hearts to hear what you have for us today. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. The Bible says that faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. It is this inner confidence about the things that we are hoping for, that they will come to pass even if we can't see them. The Bible also says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. It is impossible to please God without faith. But what happens? What happens when our faith fails? What happens when our faith wavers? What happens when our faith is weakened in life? What happens when we step out in faith and somewhere along the way, life gets too overwhelming and our faith fails? What happens then? What happens when our confidence is gone and our hope is nowhere in our mind? What happens when everything has kind of failed and all you can ask yourself is, how do I get out of this? How do I get out of this rut that I find myself in after I have fallen? There's a man in the Bible named Peter. And Peter experienced what it was like to be overwhelmed by what was going on around him to the point that his faith failed him. And I believe that there are people watching this right now today whose faith has wavered at some point, whose faith has failed them at some point, who want to please God, but you're in this rut and of not knowing how to get back on your feet and walk in faith again. And if that's you, I believe that God wants to speak to you today. I believe that today is the day that you will get out of that place of stagnation and that place of uncertainty and that place of confusion and that place and into a place of faith again. So I've titled this message, Faith to Walk Again. Tell somebody right there in your living room, Faith to Walk Again. Let's turn together to Matthew chapter 14. We're going to pick up in verse 22, read down to verse 33. Matthew chapter 14. Picking up in verse 22, I'm going to read out of the New Living Translation. You can follow along in whatever version you prefer. We're going to dive right in. Matthew chapter 14, picking up in verse 22. Here's the word of the Lord. It says, immediately after this, Jesus insisted that his disciples get back on the boat and cross to the other side of the lake while he sent people home. After sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Night fell while he was there alone. And meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from land, for a strong wind had risen and they were fighting heavy waves. And about 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water, this water of where the heavy storm was brewing and the wind was blowing and the waves were crashing over. Jesus comes walking toward them on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. And in their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost." But Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." So then Peter called to him, "Lord, if it's really you, then tell me to come to you walking on the water, not swimming, not pushing the boat closer to him. No, he says, if it's really you, Lord, ask me to come to you walking on the water. Yes, come, Jesus said. And so Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. Save me, Lord, he shouted. And Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. You have so little faith, Jesus said. Why did you doubt me? Why did you doubt me? And when they climbed back into the boat, the wind stopped, and then the disciples worshiped him. You really are the Son of God, they exclaimed. To give us some context, prior to this miraculous show of God's power in the middle of the sea or the Lake of Galilee, Jesus learned that John the Baptist had been beheaded. And so we learn earlier in this chapter in verse 13 that when he heard the news, he left on a boat to a remote area to be alone. Jesus wanted to be alone. It doesn't tell us specifically what he went there to do, except that he wanted to be alone. Alone to mourn the death of a man who paved the way for him and baptized him, marking the beginning of his public ministry. But people knew where he was headed. And so they followed him there. And when he got there and saw all this big crowd, it says he had compassion on them. And he healed them. And later in this time with them, this time together that he's spending with them, Jesus decides to feed them. And the total is believed to be to have been anywhere between 10 to 15,000 people in total, 5,000 men. And then in total, 10 to 15,000 people, including women and children. Now, once all that was said and done, Jesus sends the disciples away to cross the lake, to the other side on a boat while he dismisses these crowds. And so after everyone was gone, Jesus finally is able to go and spend some time alone in prayer. And then, in the middle of the night, at 3 o'clock in the morning, in the middle of the night, far away from land, a strong wind was rising, the waves were getting heavy, and so the disciples were in trouble and they were terrified, and Jesus saw them from afar. He saw them from his vantage point. He saw them from where he was praying on the hillside, and so he made his way toward them. Because I want to say this is the first thing I want to share with you this morning, because the storm always looks smaller when you're standing above it. The storm always looks smaller when you're standing above it. See, I believe there's two ways to look at a storm in life. There's two ways to look at a difficult situation in our life. You can either look at it from your standpoint, or you can look at it from Jesus' standpoint. One will overwhelm you and consume you, and the other will reassure you that it will be okay because you're looking at it from a higher standpoint. You're looking at it from a standpoint that can see the end from the beginning and can see that it's not going to consume you. You're seeing it for what it is. And see, the disciples were in trouble far away from a place to stand on solid ground, far away from their element, far away from security and safety, far away from being able to fend for themselves in a completely foreign element at the mercy of a storm and at the mercy of that boat holding up to that storm. They were far away from safety and battling something that was greater than they were. Something they clearly couldn't handle on themselves. Something that was paralyzing. Something that looked way too big. And he saw what was happening. Jesus saw what was happening from his standpoint. He saw what was happening from higher ground. And so here comes Jesus walking toward them in full control. Walking towards his disciples in the middle of a storm, right over the water, in full control. Walking on top of the very thing that was terrifying the disciples. Walking right over the storm in the display of his divinity and power. Walking over the storm to reassure his disciples that the one who sent them across the lake was right there with them when the crossing got tough. Jesus walked out in the middle of the lake and asked his disciples to turn their fear into courage. He asked them to turn their fear into courage. And so I wonder if you've ever experienced that in your life. Like you were facing something in life that was greater than you. A situation that was overpowering you. Something that you clearly had no control over. Something that was overpowering you. And it was at that time, not early, not late, but right on time that Jesus showed up in your life and said, don't be afraid, take courage, I am here. It was at that time that Jesus gave you the confidence to turn your fear into courage, the courage to trust him, the courage to step out in faith, the courage to walk with him no matter how hard the wind blows or heavy the waves are as they're crashing over you. And just like he came walking over over the very thing that was terrifying his disciples, he came to you, standing tall above the source of your fear to remind you that your trust belongs in him. And so you trusted him. You trusted him. You put your trust in Jesus. You at some point stepped out in faith to conquer some things in your life that were pinning you down and holding you back. But the faith that got you out of the boat wasn't enough to keep you afloat. The same faith that got you out of that boat wasn't the same faith to keep you from wanting to go back into it. That's because distractions are the enemy of faith. Write this down. Second thing I want to share with you is distractions are the enemy of faith. See, it wasn't that Peter didn't have faith. It was that the little bit of faith that Peter had bow to his circumstances rather than to Jesus. You know, Peter gets bad press for taking his eyes off of Jesus, but he actually did have faith. He had little faith, as Jesus pointed out, but he did have faith. He had faith to step out of the boat. But the little bit of faith that he had ended up bowing to the circumstances, bowing to what was happening around him rather than Jesus. Peter stepped out in faith but became distracted by what was happening around him, and he began to sink as a result. He was walking and standing on top of the storm until he took his eyes off of Jesus and put them on the storm. He was conquering the storm. He was conquering his fear. He was stepping out in faith. He was being courageous until he took his eyes away from Jesus, and his faith was no longer able to sustain him because he put his eyes in something other than Jesus. He put his eyes on the storm. He put his eyes on how high the waves were. He put his eyes on how strong the wind was, and he began to sink. Distractions are the enemy of faith. Why do you think people all across our nation were fighting to get back to church from March to June? People all across our nation were fighting to get back into church, wanting to have church, and you need to reopen the church, and let's go back to church, and let's do church from March to June. But when the lockdowns were lifted, they never went back. Why do you think that happened? That's because Jesus had your attention when there was nothing else to distract you. When there was nothing else, when everything else was gone and out of your reach and you couldn't do it and you couldn't go to it, Jesus now had your attention. There was nothing else to distract you, so you wanted to run and flock to church. So let's do ourselves a favor. Let's stop using COVID-19 as an excuse to fall out of discipleship and fellowship. Isn't it curious that as soon as everything opened, we ran back to all of it except church? That's because distractions want to keep us from where God wants to take us in life. And like Peter, we become distracted by the situation, distracted by what's happening around us, and we fall. We fall. We take our eyes off of Jesus, and we start sinking in our problems. And we reach a pivotal point, a pivotal moment in our life, a crossroads in our faith. Perhaps the most important decision after a fall. And that is, do I stay down here drowning in my mess, or do I muster the faith to walk again? Every single time you fall, every single time we take our eyes off of Jesus and we begin to sink, and we're sinking deeper and deeper into our despair, into our situation, we have a crossroad in our faith walk. And that is, do I stay here where I am, or do I have faith? Do I muster the faith to walk again, to get up again, to move forward again? So I have to ask you, how long have you sat in that place? How long have you sat in that place of exhaustion, in that place of tiredness, in that place of disappointment in yourself or shame in your life? How long have you sat in that place right after a fall? Right there where your faith begins to fade. Right there where you feel like there is no hope, that there is no way out. I think we have a tendency in our culture to put our faith in Jesus initially, but then when we fall, we have this tendency to want to pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps. And I just want to say, listen, it doesn't work like that in faith. It doesn't work like that. You can't just pick yourself back up. We have to call out to Jesus. We have to cry out to him. And that's the decision, the crossroads that we come to. Because Jesus is readily available to walk with you again. He is readily available to walk with you again. This passage says that as soon as Peter started sinking, he called out to Jesus to save him. Immediately, as soon as he starts sinking, he took his eyes off of Jesus. He begins to sink in the water. He begins to sink in the storm. And as soon as he took his eyes off of Jesus, his initial reaction, his initial thought was to call out to Jesus and say, Jesus, please save me. To pull him up out of the water. Can you picture that moment? Can you picture that moment? Peter is drowning because his faith wavered and bowed to what was happening around him. And his immediate instinct was to call out to Jesus. And then here's a beautiful thing. It says that Jesus immediately didn't delay, didn't question up front, didn't withhold. It says that Jesus immediately, because he recognizes the sound of the voice of a son or a daughter who's in despair. He recognizes the voice, the tone of voice of you when you're in your most desperate time, when you're sinking in your situation, when you've taken your eyes off of him and you're sinking in that situation. He can recognize your voice and he can recognize when you're truly calling out to him. And so Peter is sinking and says, Jesus, save me. And it says that immediately he stretched out his hand and pulled him up. But here's the most mind-blowing part of this whole passage for me. I mean, it's very easy to miss, but it's the most mind-blowing part of this whole passage for me. Peter had to walk back to the boat with Jesus over the same waves that distracted him before. Peter had to get, once Jesus pulled him back up, Peter still had to walk back over that same water that first swallowed him. He still had to walk back over that storm and back into that boat with Jesus. It says that it wasn't until they got back on the boat that the storm stopped. It didn't stop. Jesus didn't pull him up and the storm magically went away and they walked over some nice flat still water. No, the wind and the waves were still raging. The storm was raging. And so he had to have faith to get up and to walk again. The storm didn't stop until they got back on that boat. So he had to walk over that same thing that was scaring him to death the first time. Over that same thing that made his faith waver the first time. He still had to walk back over that water again. Jesus didn't stop the storm until they were back on board, because Jesus wanted to teach Peter and all the other disciples that God won't always do away with the storm. Listen, hear me, church. God won't always do away with the storm, but he will always walk with you in the storm. The storm had to happen to increase Peter's faith. There's something that happens in a storm. There's things that we have to learn in a storm, because can I just tell you, church, life is not always great. Life is not always perfect. Things don't always go the way we want them to go. Storms do come in life. We are promised trials and tribulations in this life. And Jesus is saying, Peter, and Jesus is saying, hey, listen, you sitting in your living room, listen, when times get tough, the storm may not always go away, but I want you to know that I'm walking with you in the storm. And I'm asking you, I need you to call out to me and have faith in me and have faith to walk again. The storm had to happen to increase Peter's faith. And I believe that there are some of you who have stepped out in faith before over your marriage. You've stepped out in faith in your career, in your job. You've stepped out in faith in your calling, in the calling that God has put in your life, and you know it, and it's there. You've stepped out in faith before. You've stepped out in faith with your children, but at some point you fell off. At some point you fell off. The distractions were bigger And the same faith that got you started wasn't enough to keep you going. And God is saying, listen, I know you've fallen. I know you took your eyes away from me. I know the situation distracted you away from me instead of drawing you closer, but you need to walk in faith again. Again. You need to walk in faith again. Faith to get up again. We need faith to walk again. Faith to get up again. Faith to tackle it one more time. And God will be faithful to stretch out his hand immediately and pull you up from that storm. He is faithful to do that. He did that with Peter, and I know that he will do it with you. And so I'll leave you with this. It's hard to step out in faith. I know, I recognize it. It's not normal for us as humans to want to step out in faith, but let me tell you this, it's harder to get back up and walk over the same thing that swallowed you. It's harder. It's one thing to step out in faith, and it's a whole other thing to step out in faith and walk again over the very thing that swallowed you to begin with. So I know it's hard. But Jesus is right there with you, readily available, readily willing to walk with you again. So as Hebrews 12 says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. Don't stay where you are. Listen, don't stay where you are. You don't have to stay right there where you are. Call out to him and have faith to walk again. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God. We thank you for this time together. God, we thank you for your word. God, we thank you for the challenge you give us to have faith to walk again, oh God. God, thank you so much because you don't leave us right there. You don't leave us sinking. You are standing right there, strong over the storm, strong over what's going on, and you're saying, call out to me. God, help us be like Peter. Help us be like Peter so that we don't swallow and we sink and we stay in our pride. God, help us to call out to you and say, Jesus, save me. Jesus, I'm sorry. My faith has wavered. I've looked away. I've looked around. I've wandered off, but save me. God, help us be encouraged in the fact that you will deliver, that you will pull us up, that you will rescue. God, help us be reminded that although the storm is raging, that although the storm is beating up against our boat, God, that you are walking with us in the storm. God, help us have faith to walk again, to not stay down, to not stay pinned down by our circumstances, to fix our eyes on you again. God, continue to perfect our faith. God, we ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Well, church, thank you so much for joining us online this week. We love you, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
We now have faith to walk again. Let's be encouraged today in the Lord to know that there's nothing too big for our God. By sharing our experiences with others, it actually opens the door of our heart that we never thought could, because Jesus is so contagious as he transforms our heart to be more and more like him. If you made a decision to place your faith in God, well, we want to hear about that, and we want to help you in any way that we can. You can go to our website at thecapitalchurch.org/next steps. On that page, you can fill out a quick form so we can follow up with you. I don't know if you know this or not, but we are only 3 weeks away from Easter. It's right around the corner. It's actually one of our favorite times here at the Capitol Church as we celebrate and worship our risen Lord. We want to invite you back to in-person church if you haven't been here in a while. We take extra safety measures here at the Capitol Church to make sure that everyone has a safe worship experience. We also ask that you take part in our Plus One movement this Easter season, where we are bringing at least one person to church on Easter Sunday. I can't wait to bring my Plus One as we worship the Lord together as a family about Jesus being raised back to life. What a perfect opportunity and a perfect day to bring someone to church. You can invite somebody by either placing a yard sign in your front yard, by picking up a yard sign from the church, or you can take a gift to a friend and actually give them an invitation of our Easter service on Sunday, April 4th at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. We can't wait to see who you invite. Well, we know that every week you give to God faithfully and sacrificially, knowing that your participation in tithes and offerings is actually advancing the kingdom of God forward. If you would like to worship the Lord today with your giving, then we will be so honored and so touched if you worship the Lord in this way. See, giving to God is actually a privilege, and it's also a responsibility that we have as followers of Jesus to be able to sow into the kingdom of God. You can give today in your tithes and offerings by going to our website at thecapitalchurch.org/give. Well, we have a lot coming up this spring, and we can't wait to tell you more about it. Well, until then, we are so grateful that you're here today. We pray that you have an awesome and blessed week.